everybody, and welcome to this week's edition of Champagne and JD. You may notice a couple of things. First of all, no JD this week. Unfortunately, he's a little bit under the weather, so he's sticking to the producing duties. Get well soon, buddy. And you'll also notice this week's guest clad in a mask. We all really like that. He needs no introduction, but I'm going to give him one anyway because that's just the kind of guy I am. If you've been around horse racing for any length of time, you know this guy for any number of reasons. He's been a trainer. He's been an owner. He's been at the sales. You may have noticed him careening down the steps of Hollywood Park, Del Mar, or Santa Anita after a big win there. And in this case, I'm just doing this to lengthen it just so that he keeps the salute up. Nick Hines is with us, the Sarge. Nick, thanks very much for coming on.
Hutton, Hut, and good evening, gentlemen. And best of health to JD as I unfog my glasses. But yeah, no, maybe I should wear the mask knowing that he's actually behind the scenes directing, but it's great to be here, Andrew. It's a privilege and an honor, sir, and a blessed month of August. Here we are.
Yeah, really. Lots going on for a lot of different reasons. Lots going on at this place back here, Saratoga Racecourse. Lots of stuff going on at Del Mar. Also a big weekend up at Woodbine with our friends up there with the Woodbine Oaks. Big for me as well. First round of the Daily Gallop playoffs. I made the playoffs against all odds, despite winning only three times in that contest. I got in on ROI by the skin of my teeth, and I'm pumped. Now's the time where to make the donuts.
Yeah, no doubt. I actually entered into the Daily Gallop for the first time this year. And Gorgonzola, is that our friend's name?
Yeah, he's a really good guy.
So you know, again, they kind of looked at it as like, wow, it's great to have a celebrity in. But the reality is I see it a challenge because of the fact, you know, outside of yourself, there are so many good handicappers out there to compete and contend with. And I'm not even sure our friend from the Fox Network, Mr. Kenshin, even made it into the playoffs. Maybe the consolation bracket, but what are you going
to
do?
I think he's in the console bracket, although to be fair, the last 5 weeks or so, he's been busy with his show up in Saratoga.
Oh, okay.
So I can't hold that against him too much. I actually rallied and nailed him in our head-to-head matchup. I had a best bet in the last race of the day at Saratoga, and it was a 4-1 best bet. Needed every bit of that, and as it turned out, I needed every bit of money I could scrape up to get into the playoffs on ROI. So you'll see me on Twitter talking a little bit about that as we get closer. But for now, we've got Nick Hines here, and there are so many different directions this conversation can go because he's done just about everything there is to do in horse racing in some way, shape, or form. Lately, he's been very active at the sales for a number of clients, jet-setting around to a whole bunch of different sales, obviously in a very strange environment, a strange time for racing. What has this been like for you? I mean, I can only imagine some of the things that you've seen, some of the things that you've had to deal with just in trying to do your job. It's a strange time.
Yeah, no, it's really been kind of a start, stop type of year. And, you know, in light of the COVID-19, the pandemic, you know, when this thing began back in March, you know, I tend to be rather proactive, active with the two-year-old training sales, whether I'm working from a pinhooking standpoint or working with clients that are potentially looking for the next game changer. But I was actually in Ocala for the OBS sale in March when things began. In fact, you know, a couple of clients that I had, there were, I believe, one that actually came down. He left early due to the travel restrictions that were starting to be put in place. So it's been quite strange. And frankly, Andrew, for this year, you know, when you think that we're actually only 5 months in to this pandemic, boy, it seems a lot longer than that. And I mean, from the fact that I've had an opportunity to be present at the sales, namely the Ocala Breeder sales. I did not go to the Timonium, Maryland sale in June as I decided to go into the OBS July sale, which pushed back from June. So essentially April became June, and then June became July. I attended all three sales. I would say once you got there and you're actually on the sales grounds, it wasn't as awkward as one might think. You know, generally sales are outdoors and you're with horses and you're with showmen and show women, obviously. So once we got there, it was great. But the travel process was eerie. And I want to thank Southwest Airlines. You know, my brother, having worked there for all over 25 years, the way their planes were set up, Southwest was one of the only, if not the only, airlines that essentially didn't furlough employees. And with that, I mean, from what I understand, they're losing millions a day. But in the end, we were fortunate enough to get some really nice horses, and I'm excited for what the future holds.
I have to co-sign on Southwest. My dad flew Southwest when he came out here last month. By all indications, they're doing all the right things, keeping middle seats open, trying to maintain as much of a sense of social distancing as you can get when you're trapped in a canister with wings 30,000 feet up in the air. Not an easy thing to do. No. I am scheduled to fly cross country in December. Not currently flying Southwest. Got to tell you, that might change just based on some of the things we're seeing and hearing. But you mentioned you had a couple of two-year-olds that you really like. Any in particular stand out to you off the top of your head right now?
Well, I've worked as a horse advisor with myracehorse.com, and they launched a few years back, and was fortunate to have been asked to come in and advise on behalf as far as making essentially horse valuations and doing proposals or whatnot. And, you know, after having been a trainer for, you know, over 15 years, and being around the game my entire life, I was blessed to have actually met Mike Behrens, who is the commander in chief, and actually met him through Bruno DiGiulio. And I've known Bruno, been friends with Bruno's for countless years. And, you know, the product has grown immensely. As far as the two-year-olds are concerned, in reference to the myracehorse.com, as far as horses that have already raced, Mo Mischief, competed in partnership with Spendthrift, finished second on debut. He's entered MTO this weekend. He's one that has started already. There is a young two-year-old that Peter Miller has on behalf of a good friend and client, Michael Nentwig and partners, horse called Freakishly Fast. He is a horse that I think has a very bright future. He's a son of Fast Anna. I had a little bit of a quarter crack issue that set him back, so his name is Freakishly Fast. In regards to myracehorse.com, we've actually got Storm Shooter with Todd Pletcher in New York, a New York bred that will be debuting sometime very soon, in addition to horses that we just purchased, a couple that were just released in New York, Exacta with Psychedelic Shack, a horse that's blazingly fast, in addition to the other horse, Naismith. He's a Medallia d'Oro, and a Frosted Filly out of the Damn Girlfriend. The name eludes me for the split moment here. But so those are just a few. Certainly exciting. And, you know, obviously the future is something that we're very hopeful of being a positive one.
For sure. Lots going on. If you want to learn more about My Racehorse, search them up. There's a lot to go through, a lot to go off of. But they've got some high-profile horses already in their short existence so far. So clearly a big player in the horse racing game right now. One of the things that I wanted to ask you, and I touched a little bit on this in the interview that I did with Gary Contessa just a couple of weeks ago. When you're looking for a two-year-old at the sales, obviously there's the eighth of a mile time that you can potentially go off of, and everybody wants the 9.3s, the 9.4s, the 10 flats. I use the term breezing very, very loosely here, but what are some of the things that you look for in a two-year-old, at these two-year-old in training sales, coming from somebody who, look, I know how to read a form, I know pedigrees, that's one thing. As far as horse conformation goes, I know horses have four legs, I know there's a brain in front, and I know there's an engine in the back, and that's pretty much it. So what do you look for at these sales in a horse that you can potentially bring to your clients and say, hey, I think this one's worth it?
Well, I think you touched on some valid points, because there are a variety of things in particular with the horse. And as the old saying goes, it's not how fast they go, it's how they go fast. So like anything else, I mean, you watch the, you know, countless stars of yesteryear, say, for example, a Rachel Alexander, Andra, an American Pharaoh, Zenyatta, a Winx, for example. And, you know, I brought up this topic, in fact, with our My Racehorse Live last week. We brought in Jake Kilgore, who is involved in the Breeze Figs and stride analysis. And I'm sure when you, obviously being with DRF, you remember the Breeze Figs putting out. So essentially, he would be at these sales, and he would give the stride measurement, and as far as stride efficiency, and in addition to calculating time and then evaluating heart scores. I myself, I am all about tools, but I don't necessarily look at new age material and try and reinventing the wheel, if you get what I'm saying. I think when I'm looking at a two-year-old, in particular, the two-year-old training sale, Balance is key, not so much from a physical standpoint, but from a mental stability. If they can actually go through a two-year-old training process, obviously doing preparatory work prior to breeze day, because back years ago, they would actually have two breeze days. So they actually would give a horse an opportunity. If that particular consigner weren't happy with the first breeze, they would come back and breeze again. Unlike, for example, now, it's a one-time deal. So it's a little like American Idol. If you go in and you fail your interview, so to speak, or your audition, and chances are that horse won't sell for the amount you would hope. So for you as a buyer, for me as a scout, my job is to be able to go in. Granted, if a horse goes a blazingly 9-4, you can immediately just tack on, you know, 100,000, if you will, if the horse were to vet. Right. So I think that, as I was saying, it's trying to find that horse that's a game changer, not necessarily as a sprinter or a router, because everybody's looking for the Kentucky Derby winner. But I think if you look at history, I don't have the numbers sitting in front of me, but as far as those Kentucky Derby winners or Triple Crown winners, now granted, when you get to the Preakness and the Belmont, may have changed, but the two-year-olds in training, it's, for example, Justified. He was our last Triple Crown winner. American Pharoah was a homebred. Two-year-olds in training, obviously knowing where their history is, knowing who you're buying from, getting to know the individual during the time in which you're there. Because obviously you're clocking, you're visualizing these horses, whether or not they're sprinters or they could go a route of ground, but paying attention after the preview. Not so much to look at repository x-rays and go over that with your veterinarian and your clients, but going around the sales grounds after hours, like when the sale's over or after the preview, and see what that horse is doing in the stall, because they can give you so many little subtle signs of being comfortable or being at ease with themselves. And that, to me, with two-year-olds is probably the key element, I think, to being successful, is them being able to handle and standing that pressure. It goes far beyond the physical and soundness as far as their legs are concerned.
For sure. And I'm glad that you went into such depth about all of the different things that are involved in a two-year-old sale, because one of the things Gary mentioned, and I found this fascinating, is there are a lot of people that'll only gravitate to times on a sheet. They'll see 9-3s, 9-4s, 10 flats. But one of the things Gary mentioned was the importance of being able to spot the horses that maybe go 10-2 or 10-3, but have a really smooth stride, have some fundamental strength and some smarts to them, that maybe you can improve them 2 or 3 fifths of a second. And all of a sudden, you're getting the same horse that you would have gotten going 9-3, 9-4, 10 flat for a quarter of the price.
Yeah, no, exactly. And that's where, you know, everything is so time sensitive, if you will, in reference to, you know, if you call a client, let's say you've got a $200,000 budget, horse works 10 and 3, that client feels as if he should get a faster horse. But if you figure that, let's say, for example, a horse comes onto the track to breeze, all right? He comes out, drops the rider, runs off for 3/16 of a mile. They leg the rider back up. Then the horse goes to breeze. And as opposed to having a run up to the pole, whether they're going an eighth, a quarter, sometimes 3/8 of a mile, they start right at the pole. Well, you can do the math. Obviously, likely they're going to come up with a slower time, in addition to the fact that they dropped the rider. Now, why did the horse drop the rider? Did he have blinkers? Does he have blinkers? I've always been a believer that less is more. And I've always admired, when you go back, and obviously Secretariat is eliminated because he defies the fact that he raced in blinkers throughout his career. But when you look at the true greats of history and you think about equipment, obviously Bob Baffert may be eliminated from this because of the fact that he likes the blinkers and the shadow roll. Bob Baffert goes to that famed blue shadow roll. Generally, it's a good sign. But all in all, I like to go into a situation where less is more. I don't like bandages. You know, you as a handicapper, you see front wraps being added. Certain trainers, especially back east, because of the tracks and the fact that they have more sand and horses tend to burn their heels and run down, maybe there is protection. But I'm just not a fan of more equipment. I think less is more. So when I see a two-year-old that breezes in a sale, much like the Frosted that I alluded to for myracehorse.com, she raced with no blinkers that day, or worked with no blinkers that day. And she actually kind of looked a little soft in the flesh to me. So I said to myself, there's more to this. So as Gary had mentioned, it's having that ability as a buyer in our position. Now, granted, I haven't had the opportunity to go to a sale and raise my hand. You know, I advise for my racehorse and they purchase some higher end horses, but for me directly, having a client that's going to spend $500,000, I haven't had the opportunity to do that. Now, Behind It to Bar was the first 2-year-old training I bought. Had a client that came to me and said, at the time I was still training, and not to go off on a tangent, but he had said, I want you to find me a Derby horse. You're getting one chance. I spent $140,000. Long story short, he broke his maiden career start number two. Satish Sanan bought the majority. Client stayed in. Horse won Lexington, became Kentucky Derby eligible. Satish decided on side of the horse, too quick of a turnaround. They decided to pass and go on to the Preakness. I think he was second choice. Scratched that day with a foot issue and never raced again. So the moral of the story is that when you have that opportunity, it's a positivity thing. And you mentioned Mel Studi. And, you know, there's not one person, I think, on this planet that could say anything negative about Mel Studi, because he was the incurable optimist. When the clock struck midnight, no matter how bad of a day he may have had the day before, when he woke up, he was a winner. And I think that's what separates you being in this game and you as a handicapper, Andrew, and JD, obviously under the weather this week. I think you're going to attest to the fact that if you truly wake up in the morning and you just say, you know, I'm going to have a terrible day. Well, guess what? Chances are you will. If you say you're going to have a great day, it doesn't quite work out. At least you tried to get there. And I think the same applies to horse racing at any level.
Yeah. And I'm happy you brought up Mel Studi, because I obviously wanted to chat with you a little bit about that. Unfortunately, earlier this week, news came down that Mel Studi passed away just a couple of days after his 93rd birthday. And really, once you get up past 90, it really does become a celebration of life kind of thing. Mel Studi living a full life at the racetrack and wound up training a lot of very good horses. He trained Snow Chief, trained a couple of other champions, trained a winner of the Breeders' Cup Sprint by the name of Very Subtle. Very good horseman. And as you mentioned, a guy that a lot of people have really fun stories about.
Well, the one thing about Mel, and it was interesting because I remember this conversation, and again, condolences to his wife, Annabelle, of course, his son, Gary, and daughters and grandchildren. Fortunate to have had him here for that long. And I think John Sadler was even quoted as saying, you know, for a guy that lived like Mel Studi, it's amazing that he lived to be 93. And if you haven't had an opportunity, it was just, I think, last week that Janine Sahadi had actually posted up a video, because they had a drive-by birthday celebration. Bob Baffert, his wife Jill, there, of course, Vince DeGregory, my longtime friend, and his as well. But, you know, Mel obviously played the game in such a way that he kept the faith. And he was asked years ago, if you think about Very Subtle, the fact that she went on to make, what did she make in her career? Over 1.6 million. And when you put that into context, we're talking about the 80s, Andrew. So what does 1.6 million mean today in today's world? He purchased her for $30,000. And the question was asked to him at some point, well, why do you buy all these mid-level budget type horses? He said, I like to buy in the $20,000 to $30,000 range. That way I can run them for a $20,000 tag in case I need to move them along. You can get out. You have that opportunity. So that actually almost would put the conversation we had in reference to the 2-year-old sales and obviously the yearling sales. But I think what really struck me the most about Mel was the fact that he had the ability to win races on various surfaces. Do you remember a one-eyed filly that he had later on in her career? Real Connection? I don't know if you remember.
It rings a bell.
Yeah, she was unbelievable as far as her heart and desire. She ran on the turf, and the one thing about Mel is that he trained his horses very hard. And Bob Baffert had actually stamped the phrase Melvinized. And I think if you recall, and obviously you look at the Bob Baffert style of training now, you say to yourself, boy, he trains very hard. I almost feel like in the grand scheme of things, that Mel Studi actually kind of taught, not to say he taught Bob Baffert how to train, but in regards to his mode of training, I think he enlightened Bob Baffert. I think he enlightened him to the fact that these horses can be tested. And I think in today's world, as trainers, and I myself being a former trainer, I think often, I think we're very cautious of how we train, and we're constantly trying to protect horses, if you hear what I'm getting at. So I think when it's all said and done, one thing about Mel Studi, he wasn't afraid to take a chance. He was always willing to listen. The numerous times that I know I came about, there were $2 bettors, $20 bettors. They would ask him for a loan. I don't think he ever saw that money again. And whether or not it was the fact that he gave him the loan so they would never ask him again, or at the end of the day, he just simply was that great of a guy. And I know he was. And the Mel Studi bar, you may recall it, Fairplex, they had designated that for him because he was enlisted in the Hall of Fame at Fairplex. And he was once asked about the Hall of Fame and how he felt and, you know, where his mind was with all that. And at the end of the day, I think he was more proud of being in the Fairplex Hall of Fame than anything.
He was an institution at Fairplex. I believe he won 12 training titles at that bullring track in Pomona. And he won a lot of big races with a lot of big horses. However, if that name rings a bell for some more casual horse racing fans, it might be because he got paid the ultimate respect by Hollywood. He got name dropped in the horse racing classic, Let It Ride. If you listen to the background with Trevor Denman, you hear Trevor Denman saying, Mel Studi, trainer Mel Studi, please contact the jockey's room. And you have to think that he would have loved that.
Well, absolutely. And I think the other point, you know, about Mel is that he was so humble. I think, you know, like I said, he was just one of those that was happy-go-lucky. He didn't have any stress. Obviously, you know, as a former trainer, it's a 365-a-day-a-year season. But the one thing I always recognize about Mel is he always had people around him. And why is that? Because the people love to hear his stories. But more importantly, they love his positivity and his enthusiasm. But despite the fact that he's a Hall of Fame caliber and does belong in the National Museum Hall of Fame for horse racing, he's so humble and he's so kind. And, you know, an interesting story, Andrew. This is going back to 2009, I believe it was. And I was kind of going through a little bit of a flux struggle. I'd gotten out of training in 2007, had no regrets. It was a life change. My wife and I were at the time trying to have a child, and I was offered a job to go to work with Southern Equine as a racing manager. And it was a difficult decision because when you're young and you're wanting to become a horse trainer and the dream comes true and you've got a stable full of 30 horses, you're making that life change. And I did in 2007. So as I was making this transition, if you will, you know, I gambled and I still do. And horses are my passion, as you know, but it was in 2009. And I believe it was closing day at Del Mar. And it was a horse by the name of Gilligan that won the nightcap under Agapito Delgadillo. And the horse was 13-1. And that landed me a pick six that day multiple times. So for Mel Studi, that memory that I had of him and, you know, seeing him at the racetrack. And I, you know, going back to this is taking it all the way back to 1990. They used to have an owner trainer lounge at Hollywood Park that was actually on Century Boulevard, not the new one that they put in where the swimming pool was. But I remember going to the owner trainer lounge at the time. I was working for Bob Hess Jr., whom we had great success together for over four plus years. But I remember seeing Mel Studi, and because of his, you know, accolades and obviously knowing what he had done with the likes of Very Subtle, Snow Chief, I was like, that's Mel Studi. But listening to him talk, I said, Mel Studi, just a fun-loving guy. What a great guy. And I introduced myself to him. And just, you know, again, I had an opportunity to get to know Warren, his brother. And, you know, Warren was a tremendous horseman in his own right. But Warren was different. You know, he was a little, you know, closer kind of to the vest and, you know, a little on the quieter end of things. But what I loved about that relationship is that Mel brought out the best in Warren and vice versa. Watching those two together, I've got fond memories as a former trainer. And I can honestly say that, you know, as my privileges of having been a trainer was getting to know hard boot horsemen like them, because they were the epitome of hard boot, and there were no frills to their game.
I love hearing those stories. I am such a sucker for stories like that, where you get down into not just what they've accomplished on the track, but the people that they are and the stories behind their success and how hard they work. Because there are some people out there who think, oh, trainers just show up for a couple of hours in the morning, then they go to the races in the afternoon in fancy suits, whatever. Not the case. This stuff is hard. There is a reason that I chose to be on the front side of the racetrack and not on the back side of the racetrack. Right. And it's not just because me and manual labor have never, ever gotten along. It's fascinating to hear this stuff. I love these stories. So many characters in this game and so many really cool stories. It's fantastic. And unfortunately, losing Mel Studi, a bit of a blow to that. But 93 years old, very full life. I'm not wearing a hat. I should be, because you are, but hats off. Mel Studi, rest in peace. We'll miss you. You mentioned a lot of stuff about your time as a trainer. Now, if you're watching this show, you probably saw the video that I tweeted a couple of days ago of Nick Hines cutting wrestling promos as he comes down the stairs. I believe that was at Hollywood Park. And that's just, you look at that and it's impossible not to come away with a smile. And that's what a lot of people said. The fact that they loved your energy, loved your passion for what you did as a trainer. As somebody that was in this day in, day out, you go through a stretch where, you know, you go 0 for 10 or 0 for 15, it starts wearing on you a little bit. How hard is it to have that kind of upbeat energy sometimes? Because there are dry times in this game, and I have to imagine that was you switched on, but you get a chance where, you know, you're going 0 for 20 and you lose 3 or 4 photos. It's hard, man.
Well, it's interesting you say that, you know, Andrew, because I took the leap of faith back in 94, and I believe it was my third starter that I'd won with that day, Corey Black, aboard a horse by the name of Chief Brody, who was actually a brother to Tark the Shark, whom I worked with Bob Hess. He was a son of Clever Trick. Chief Brody was by It's Freezing. We claimed him off of Sandy Shulman at the time, and I remember the day he won at Hollywood Park, and recently my family and I moved to try to get cash into some better schooling out of central Los Angeles. But bottom line is that I remember when Chief Brody was entered first off the claim, and the clients had asked me, and God rest Red Richie's soul, because he gave me my first chance. And partner said, what do you think of the horse today? I said, he can't lose. He cannot lose. So we're in the paddock, and they look at me and they said, you still think this horse can't lose? I said, he can't lose. Looked up at the board at the time, he was 50-1. Ended up going off at 40-1. Paid 83 and some change. Owners, you know, they had their wives had pocketfuls of cash. And it was like, to myself, I thought, you know what? Man, this game's, it's easy. When you're young and vital, I just graduated Cal Poly Pomona, and I'd worked with Bob Hess up until that point. And obviously, when I was getting my degree, I had to kind of shore up the track work. So you say that, Andrew. So you get to the point where you think it's easy, right? Well, guess what? I think I went on an 0 for 40 streak at that point. And I can say there were at least 6, maybe 7 photos where I got beat an inch or less. So the moral of the story is, it's twofold. Don't get too cocky, but keep yourself humble. But when you get the wins, enjoy it. So as time marched on, Red Richie unfortunately passed away in 96. And then I was roommates with Craig DeLasse and a good friend of ours, and Greg Long. And Craig needed an assistant. I had like probably 4 or 5 at the time. So we ended up winning the training title at Hollywood Park. We had re-raise in 98. Things were gelling again. I won some races on my own. So it was kind of an ebb and flow. I think that as a trainer, as a former trainer, I think you have to kind of go into survival mode. I think in the end, what I really learned from it all, and it really pertains to life, because I've always felt that horse racing, while we've always kind of enjoyed our little bubble, which in today's world, it feels like parts of the bubble have bursted, because that's what society is right now. There's such this divisiveness that we have. And now in horse racing, everyone has an opinion, and opinions are great. Everyone's entitled to it. But at the end of the day, when you're challenging the likes of trainers who are in and out of these stalls every day with these horses, interacting with their employees, sometimes you got to kind of let it be. So what I tell you and what I say to our friend JD and to the world out there is, as a trainer, as a horse player, as a gambler, don't let the game consume you. And I think in the end, that was the biggest lesson I learned. It was a point of being able to step away and exhale. Try not to take the world on your shoulders, because you as an individual, if you're putting in the time each day, not to go to a spiritual end of things, but he's watching. You're here for a purpose, and you're here to make the difference. So essentially, it's on you to do that. And going back to the training days, I'm asked virtually every other day, do you miss it? Absolutely. I miss the horses in particular. I don't miss the headaches of some of the owners that I may have had that tried to micromanage and do whatnot in this. But through the years, I've established some wonderful relationships. And, you know, even owners today, Paul Gerdner is probably in his mid-80s. We're partners on horses. Nick Casado with Slam Dunk Racing recently, over the last 2 years, which I'm surprised it took us that long. But we went out to the sales, and one particular horse, El Tigre Terrible, he turned out to be a California champion. We paid, I think, $18,000 for him, and he was obviously coming off a big win in the Real Good Deal, Vertical Threat, another one in partnership with MyRacehorse.com. So the relationships that I have evolved, and again, in light of speaking to Mel Studi, who obviously passed away, I think that there's so much that can be taken from this game in lessons in life. But I think at the end of the day, just consume you and remember that you don't have to gamble on every race, and seek opportunity, pick your battles, just as you would training a horse. You want to put your horse in a tough company. It's the old saying, keep yourself in the best of company, keep your horses in the softest and worst of company.
You know, I'm liking this as an interviewer, because you're taking all of my questions and I don't have to ask them. This is great, man. I'm loving this.
I have that knack, right? No, but hey,
it's almost like you work in television or something. You got a gift. The one thing that I do want to ask you, and this is something that I was thinking of all day today leading up to this, and you mentioned a couple of things in particular, but in the stuff that you've been fortunate enough to do as a trainer, as a bloodstock agent, whatever, what is one thing you wish more people knew that a lot of people don't?
Wow. I mean, I think I'd almost have to have you repeat that question, because
it's just a matter of, every day you see things on social media and you wonder where they're coming from, because as you mentioned, everybody's got an opinion, and you know what? That's great. One of the things that I love about this game, and one of the things that I love about, you know, anything, is horse racing is paramutual betting. It's my money against your money. If you're right, great. If I'm right, great. If we're both wrong, there's another race in 30 minutes. Or if you want to really get crazy, there's a simulcast over there and there's another race in 8 minutes from a track that we've never heard of. So I guess the big thing is, what's one thing that you see in horse racing that from firsthand experience you can say, you know what, you're not getting the whole story, or you're misinformed? Just what's something that when you see it, wherever it might be, whether it's on TV, whether it's on social media, whether it's in conversation, you just go, oh man, here's the way this works.
Well, I think first and foremost, I think the most difficult aspect of horse racing is, like anything else, is transparency, full transparency, in a sense that
I just tweeted a bobblehead. Anytime anybody says the word transparency or optics, I go into bobblehead mode.
Here's the difficulty of the fact that we want transparency is, I think that knowing as a former trainer, there are so many things that can get so misconstrued in a given situation. I mean, I remember during the Triple Crown when Justify, you remember when that video went out and he took a couple of funny steps behind and people were like, oh, he's lame, he shouldn't be running, and God forbid Bob Baffert is running this horse. What is he doing? You know, he killed four horses at Hollywood. It's like, stop. You need to stop. So I feel as if the people that are making suggestions are those that should have skin in the game. When I read posts from Craig Burnick of Glen Hill, I love his approach because of the fact that he's been involved. Now, some can say, well, you know, Craig Burnick's been he's been fortunate because he has inherited all sorts of money. But no, he has seen what his family has gone through the years. And as a gambler, I'm going to throw someone out there. I'm going to throw out Andy Asaro. Okay. I personally know that there are certain people in the horse industry that don't like Andy Asaro. Okay. I don't know him as well as maybe I could or potentially should, as we will. But I do realize at the end of the day that his beef, for example, with California in regards to takeout, how certain things are handled, I feel as if the industry needs to do better for the gambler. You look at the smaller venues. Let's throw out Sam Houston. Let's try Canterbury, for example. And you talk about takeouts and how they're set up. Then you compare a track like Penn National, whose takeouts are ridiculous. So are they looking out for the gambler? Do they need the gambler's money? Absolutely they do. So going back to the people that feel as if they have a well-educated opinion in the social media world, they need to take a step back and say, am I well-educated enough to have a proper opinion? And who's to say whether or not their opinion is right or wrong? But for me, from a transparency standpoint, it's the old a few good men line. You can't handle the truth. So if you were to actually have, I know that there's been certain doctors or veterinarians that have Facebook or Twitter posts that have actually sent out like the confidentials for the veterinarians, like these horses that ran in the Travers last week.
Yeah.
The things that you see on those lists are virtually so minuscule and mean nothing. Yet when you see anti-inflammatory, your brain goes off and you go, oh my God, that horse has a big problem. But at the end of the day, you're talking about a 1,000-pound animal that can go up to a rate of 43, 45 miles per hour that hits at 5,000 pounds per square inch. These are athletes, all right? And then you get the other side of the coin where you have, you know, the rights activists. You know, these horses should be out in the wild somewhere. The reality is these horses were bred to do this since back in medieval times. This was a sport that has been devised for countless hundreds and hundreds of years. It's not something that just we took horses in, domesticated them, and say, we're going to make a racehorse. So the point is, you have all of these forces, right? So I tell you, and I tell the folks that are out there on Twitter, in the social media world, use the Andy Asaros, use the Craig Burnicks, use the Andrew Champagnes, use the Scott Hazeltons of the world to potentially enlighten you on how we can make this a better sport. Don't just judge the person because he has a character issue. I'm not perfect, but there are certain things that I know that could make the game better. But when it comes down to transparency, I personally think the track officials, whether they be the stewards, the racing secretaries, track ownership, I think they can do a far better job in the transparency aspect and knowing who they're dealing with. And, you know, we've had two trainers that were suspended over the last 6 months. We all know who they are. And I don't know if they're up for trial. The FBI has done that investigation, withholding the person, Saudi, for Gary and Mary West. Now people are up in arms because, you know, Gary, why is he upset? And he shouldn't be upset because, you know, his trainer was a chief. The bottom line is we don't know. So your opinion isn't formulated and not educated enough to give an opinion. So I think if we were to that aspect of it, I think we could do a much better job of getting along and trying to coexist here because, I mean, at the end of the day, we're not all going to be drinking buddies like Mel Studi would have with his crew at Clocker's Corner. We're not all going to get along, unfortunately.
Unfortunately is right. And one of the things that I've seen is just one of those observations is, when did it become a bad thing to disagree with someone and have a conversation? Because not everyone is going to approach every situation exactly the same, but if you can come away with a conversation of, look, I don't agree with you, but your situation's different than mine. You're dealing with stuff I'm not dealing with. I'm dealing with stuff you're not dealing with. Let's talk about this and maybe find some common ground here. Unfortunately, we live in a culture, and this could be a far bigger podcast, a far longer podcast, where the ultimate currency isn't being right, it's being loud. And that's something that doesn't just apply to horse racing, it applies to life. So I think there's a lot of validity in that. And it's not necessarily to say, look, here's what we believe, here's da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. It's just be open to conversation. You don't have to say, this is the only way to do things. Ask right. questions.
Right.
I wrote a column.
You hit the nail on the head. I think ask questions is the thing we learned at a very young age. And in particular, there's no such thing as a bad question. And the one particular thing, as we have tried to bring millennials into this particular sport, is, in fact, the educational standpoint. So let's say you're 20 years of age, and let's say you want to get into horse racing. Let's say you get into the social media world. Wow. I mean, it's for me, it ends up being overwhelming. You get to the point where you say to yourself, why would I want to get into this thing? There are a bunch of crazy Looney Tunes in here. So that was, you know, again, I was blessed because of the numerous things. I mean, obviously, I was raised in Las Vegas, my father being an attorney, the Nevada State Race Commissioner back in the early 70s. Unfortunately, Thunderbird Downs closed by the time I was born. Eventually, we had Las Vegas Downs in the early 80s, which had a Greyhound and Thoroughbred track. It was a beautiful facility out toward Henderson. They made it through the Greyhound meeting. They ran out of money by the time they get to the Thoroughbreds in the winter because it was too hot to run Thoroughbreds during the summer. But when I look back at all of that, I just say to myself, all right, I was raised as a gambler, right? So as a horseman. So when I come to the racetrack, I see all these varying personalities, but it's that personality. Remember, I went back into the microcosm of society, and there was a way. I hope there is a way, but there was a way back in the late 80s, early 90s, that trainers could coexist. They really did get along. And I remember in the latter years of Jack Van Berg, and God bless him and God rest his soul, because he left Hollywood Park at the perfect time when he, and bless Chris Katulak for writing a book. I remember how much work he put into it. But with Jack, it was one of those where he always had a story, and I was blessed enough, as Bobby Frankel was still alive, as a trainer, I'd go down to the guinea stand. You had Bobby Frankel, you had Jack Van Berg, you had the middle stand at Hollywood Park by the racing office, Janine Sahadi, then you had the left wing by the kitchen where you had Neil Drysdale and Richard Mandela. So you tell me, you can learn so much from them, and then obviously you have the claiming end of it, the late, great Mike Mitchell. You even speak to a Sandy Shulman, who was a former photographer. But there was so much that went into it. So I guess the moral of the story is that God gave you two ears, one mouth. It's good to be a listener. It's good to ask questions. But sit back. If you're having a confrontation with someone on Twitter and their opinions and their suggestions aren't validated in your mind, I don't block them. I just simply mute them. Because the reality is when you block them, there's other people that can still see it anyway. But for me, look, I'm a forgiver. So if you've got something that you want to discuss with me, but as you know, in today's world, in the craziness that we've got with the pandemic, you know, people tend to be more negative. They're spending more time at home. They're not getting out as much, which they could easily go on a walk around the neighborhood or perhaps go to the nearest park. They're allowed to do that. So get your mind out, get refreshed, and don't be so hard on yourself. And I think a lot of these frustrations that you see in social media, a lot of those people are just, they're being way too critical upon themselves, and they just vent, and they get after it in the sense that it's only going to make things worse. So take a step back, exhale, and use tomorrow as an opportunity.
I'll tell one story that I don't think I have ever told before, and it's inspired by the fact that you're bringing up the importance of just listening and learning and being around people who know what they're doing. Leading up to the 2016 Breeders' Cup, I was working for an outlet that you, Nick Hines, might have heard of. And I was at Santa Anita leading up to the Breeders' Cup with all of the workouts and everything that's going on. And TVG had a crew of people, some of the best people in the game at that point. And Gary Young, the private clocker, was with us every morning. And I just sat next to him for 3 or 4 days. And what an education you get listening to someone and seeing the way they do things when they've been doing this for 40 years and they know the ins and outs of absolutely everything. Seeing him with the stopwatch and the tape recorder and the notepad, that taught me as much, maybe more, about anything in horse racing as any other experience that I have ever had. The other reason I bring this story up is the funny part. So this was during the 2016 World Series, which featured Gary Young's beloved Chicago Cubs. Neil Drysdale did something you never, ever, ever, ever do. Neil Drysdale walked up to Gary the morning after the Cleveland Indians took a 3-1 lead in the series. And Neil goes in this Pink Panther on helium voice, "How are your Cubs doing?" Gary goes, "About as good as your barn, Neil." And he goes up one side and down the other of Neil Drysdale, one of the great trainers that's living right now, the guy who can't beat Indy and Fuseichi Pegasus. And he's looking at all of us with this look like, "Are you going to let this madman keep going?" And all of us were like, "Yep, we're not stopping him. Keep going, Gary." And he punctuates this with about the greatest insult I have ever heard at a racetrack that's clean. The insult that he used was, "I would bet on the Chicago Cubs coming back from a 3-1 deficit to win the World Series before I bet on a first-time starter from your barn."
That is great.
I'll keep that with me the rest of my life.
Well, that's the thing. And I think that, you know, Gary, obviously not only a clocker, a private clocker that does a great job, and I know there was an issue had him not being able to go out to Santa Anita in the mornings when this thing was getting into full swing. Hopefully, I haven't spoken to him probably since the last sale, but hopefully he's getting, you know, out to Del Mar or whatnot. But Gary has a very good eye at the sales as well. You know, the horse that comes to mind when I became affiliated and knowing who Gary Young was Brocco back in the day. And for the Brockleys and Randy Winnick, of course, being the trainer. But Gary's got a good eye for it. And what's interesting is that when you think about Gary Young, you're like, he's not a horseman. He wasn't a trainer. But because of the fact that he can differentiate in the mornings, and as I mentioned Bruno DiGiulio earlier, Bruno is one that, you know, obviously I having a relationship with him for years, he did, in fact, allow me to get the job at Today's Racing Digest when I was kind of going through that struggle back in 96, 97. This was just as I was going to work with Craig Galassi. But Bruno, for me, as far as clockers and noting horses and the signs, I think Bruno, for me, is the best in that regard. I think that when we've had this discussion, Bruno and I, you know, when you kind of go off to the point of having an opinion, everyone is entitled to that opinion. Of course, he does the work and due diligence. But there are times when I think you kind of you want to believe that that horse can do better. Whereas, say, for example, the guy like Gary Young, it's black and white. But why Bruno and I obviously got along was the fact that we could actually see different colors. So we'd give it the opportunity. So I guess when you're playing at a given level, now, for example, you have a Hall of Fame trainer in Bob Baffert. He doesn't want to hear about that horse that you're going to go to the sale. The real quiets for the 17,000, the silver charms for the 16,000, whatever you pick, they don't exist anymore. No. I mean, he's going for the creme de la creme. And I mean, Bob Baffert is obviously getting older. He's accomplished in winning 2 Triple Crowns. So when you talk about clockers, as far as their ability to kind of enlighten you on things, to me, those guys are two of the best. Toby Terrell, I think, has always done a nice job. And for the clockers in the East, you've got Mike Welsh of DRF. These are valuable tools. But I love the fact that they have their opinions. But I think the importance is for you to kind of take the nuggets of what they give out. But you talk about the personality, going back to your conversation with Gary Young and Neil Drysdale. As I said before, this game will really humble you. I remember Charlie Whittingham once. I think he went over 80 during a certain phase. Can you imagine Charlie Whittingham in today's world of social media? Not that he would care, former Marine Corps and quite the gentleman in his own right. I don't think he'd worry about it, but still. In today's world, going 0 for 80, you'd be under a lot of fire in the social media world.
Steve Clothen going 0 for 120 or 1 for 120, losing the mound on affirmed. Can you imagine that, him going over to Europe to get his career back? Wow. Can you imagine how that would be interpreted by Twitter today?
Unbelievable. And that's my point. I think that as we look at Twitter, you have to, you know, and that's the, for example, in my position as a bloodstock consultant, bloodstock agent, it feels a little awkward when you actually self-promote. But, you know, websites are still a thing, but they're kind of a thing of the past. It's almost as if now in this world, you have to really self-promote yourself in order to have someone recognize. It's not just picking up a phone and saying, hey, this is Nick Hines, or hey, this is Andrew Champagne. This is what I have to offer you today. It would be great if we could do that all day, but Twitter is kind of that mouthpiece, so to speak. But, you know, I try to shine a positive light. If there are those out there that want to detract from something, look, if they've got a constructive way of coming at me, I'm fine with it. But they have one sole purpose to kind of break me down, then I kind of move on to the next subject, because it's really not worth it. But in regards to the social media world, it's a wonderful thing if you use it to your advantage. And I think, you know, some wonderful relationships have also come about as a result of social media. I mean, it's a different world now. It's no longer, especially this year, as far as having the social ability to go to the tracks. I mean, Andrew, you remember. I mean, you look back at, I remember, actually, I'm going to tell you a quick story. So about 4 years ago, I had someone that private messaged me on Facebook. For some reason, until about 2 months ago, I didn't see the message. It was the most random thing. Gentleman comes on there and says, hey, I have a cassette tape of Good Lord. That was my dad's horse that he was a turf horse in the meeting in 79 at Del Mar. Bill Shoemaker, Charlie Whittingham, you probably saw the post.
Yeah.
But he said, I have a cassette tape of Good Lord. So he sent me this cassette tape. I had to literally ask my mother-in-law for a cassette player because I didn't have one. Put the cassette in, and it was Dave Johnson. It was the San Juan Capistrano, 1979, and a horse by the name of Tiller, nosed out Exceller on the wire. Good Lord was entered in that race, and I vividly remember being there that day with my family. Good Lord was a deep closer. He won the Sydney Gold Cup in Australia. He won the Wellington Cup multiple times. That's the Wellington Cup behind me. I'm in the process of putting a case together. But hearing that call, I remember exactly where I was that day, and I remember Dad saying, why is he on the lead? He was a deep closer. Well, Whittingham used him as a rabbit for Exceller. In the end, Exceller got beat anyway. Tiller ended up winning the race, but it's that memory, knowing that day, and I researched it, there were 50,000 people that day at Santa Anita. It was closing day. I know it was 1979, but even into the 80s, you had countless people to track. You go to the track on a given day, Saturday, normal day, no COVID-19 pandemic, what, maybe 10,000? So it's not what it was. And that's where I think we, as ambassadors of the game, you, JD, myself, we need to go out and share the love of how much this game has to provide. And I think there's still hope. I don't like reading an article today in regards to Turf Paradise that due to the COVID-19 pandemic, they're going to not race. But
sorry, JD.
Yeah. So a Turf Paradise, you know, it's a little tattered and worn, but it's still a good facility. And God bless those horsemen and women over there that have put so much time and effort into the breeding programs and whatnot. They don't even have a track to race at this point in time. Think about the countless dollars that they've spent and now are going to lose as a result of that carpet being slipped from underneath them. And I just think it was kind of a cheap shot, sad story. Hopefully someone else will pick up the baton and maybe get Arizona back in order.
Fingers crossed on that. Yeah. I mean, we've covered a lot of ground from the horse racing perspective, and this has been a really fun conversation. But JD just hinted at something. He just sent a message over to us, and this is a very touchy subject because there is one thing that we are on complete opposite sides of, and it is, for my money, the best rivalry in all of college football. You a fan of those little guys with the gold helmets from South Bend, and me a fan of the mighty Michigan Wolverines. JD has asked a question, and he wants to know, how much would Notre Dame football moving to the spring, if that happens? Obviously, we don't know anything about what's going on right now, and even if we did, it might well change in 3 or 4 days. But how much would Notre Dame football moving to the spring as opposed to the fall, impact the Hines household?
Well, I think at the end of the day, knowing that Notre Dame basketball hasn't probably been that relevant since LaFonso Ellis, maybe. I was going to go back to the Trafuca days.
Years ago, they weren't bad. They've made the tournament consistently, and I will say Mike Bray's a heck of a coach.
I agree. But I think at the end of the day, so as far as there being a conflict of interest, you know, I spent 1 year in Kansas at St. Mary's as an NAIA school. This is back in 89 after my first year at UNLV. And I went there as a result of, you know, wanting to play college basketball. It was Division II, but I became a huge Kansas fan at that time because, I mean, when you're in Kansas, it's all about basketball. So people often ask me, hey, Notre Dame, Kansas, which is it? I said, it's just Kansas basketball. But as far as Notre Dame and the ring, look, man, I turned a hatchery old this year. And the trip that we had planned, we planned on going to Greece with the family, taking a cruise, obviously went out the door. Unfortunate, but good news is, you know, my family's good. We're healthy and knock on wood. So it's like kind of it's a wash this year. But we planned on going to the Notre Dame-Clemson game the first week of November in South Bend. So the fact that it potentially would transition into the spring, I think it would work out perfectly because you've got Keeneland Spring, Notre Dame spring football. It's just a 6.5 hour drive away. I think it would do all right. It would give Brian Kelly an opportunity to get strong that much or squad that much stronger. Again, Lawrence, whether or not he's going to stay at Clemson, if this all goes down, they don't have the season. Such a tricky situation, but as you know, just like horse racing, I mean, horse racing is a spectator sport. Well, it should be, but in regards to the football, it's entirely different than, say, for example, the bubble they have for the NBA. It just it won't be the same. And I would prefer they err on the side of caution to get in a quarter of the season and say we're gonna fan it. You know, my dad, having played there in 38, 42, enlisted in the Marine Corps, you know, I had said that and told you the story that he played under Frank Leahy and played with the Heisman Trophy winner, Angelo Bertelli. He played on the undefeated team, I believe it was in 41, that tied Army that year. But dad played both sides of the lines. And, you know, when you think about that, I had an opportunity to take my son, my wife for the first time as well to go to the campus at Notre Dame. It's every bit as magical as you see in the movie Rudy, but tenfold. And knowing that my father had attended there is a tremendous thing. And on a side note, Andrew, a horse that I recently acquired at the OBS July sale, and I saved this name for the right horse. Well, he's a two-year-old by Shaking It Up, but Dam's name was Holy Touch. So I saved Touchdown Jesus for a particular horse. So there's the perfect segue. So put Touchdown Jesus in your stable mail. He's in training with Jim Chapman in Kentucky. He's probably 60 days away from a race. I'm excited. Touchdown Jesus, you can keep an eye on him. And of course, that might work out perfectly with Notre Dame spring football.
You know, if you're going to be a Notre Dame fan, having a dad that played at Notre Dame, that's a darn good reason. I can't knock that. Though I will say, I just got a call on my phone. Denard Robinson says hello.
Denard.
Yeah.
Wow.
Shoelace, the guy that single-handedly destroyed Notre Dame. Just saying. I love that. There was one year where I think Michigan was down 28-7 at halftime, and my friends were giving me all sorts of crap. And then weird stuff started to happen. That was the night where Eminem got into the broadcast booth with Musburger and Herb Street.
Oh, my gosh.
It was a really weird evening. And somehow Michigan wound up winning the game. I have no idea how or why it happened. I think Robinson hit Roy Roundtree for the game-winning touchdown. But, no, it's just I want college football to do well. I really, truly do. Erring on the side of caution, I think, is something that you and I both share the same opinion on. Look, nobody wants college football to be canceled. And that's the one thing that I'll say as sort of a final thought. If you're out there and you think that people who make their living covering these sports that are getting canceled, not just reporters, sports information directors at colleges. That was my first job out of school. I worked in the athletic department at Siena College covering 18 different Division I sports. If you think anyone that is associated with college sports is rooting for sports to be canceled, no, just stop. That's not the way the world works. People want other people to be safe. Now, we can disagree about the way that they're doing that, and that's healthy, but this is one of those situations, and I've stressed this in a couple of conversations on this show. Sometimes there are no good options, and this is one of those things. So I think erring on the side of caution, not the worst thing in the world. Certainly avoiding lawsuits and any sort of legal action was a priority there, but at the same time, not getting too far into it, but just something to remember. And it ties back into what we were talking about social media. You can have an opinion, and that's fine. You don't always have to know everything or act like you know everything.
No, and you're right. I mean, I think the reality of that is having an educated opinion. And for example, in regards to the football, college football, it's interesting to note that Notre Dame, Michigan, their first game took place in 1887. And, you know, kudos to you because your Michigan Wolverines actually have advantage Notre Dame. I think that rivalry is 23-17. But when that rivalry kind of went by the wayside, I was just devastated because that, and I know it came back and, you know, the idea is for it to come back. But, you know, as far as the conference thing in Notre Dame, look, they've capitalized on their independency and the fact with their networks, they're always going to be Notre Dame. And I get laughed at because when they made it into the semis against Clemson last year, I had a fairly sizable championship bet on them. I hedged slightly, but I still feel that there are a couple of plays when you go back and look at that game against Clemson where, man, I feel like they maybe could have, but maybe they weren't prepared. But at the end of the day, they're probably undermanned. But anyway, so that being said, I would love the opportunity if Notre Dame football came back and did come in the spring and you could kind of intersect a Keeneland spring meet with Notre Dame pending spectators being allowed to go.
Yeah. So it's a case of trying to make the best out of a bad situation. Racing has done that and has stumbled upon a couple of things that definitely work. A lot of tracks experimenting with new things, new post times, new meet schedules. A lot of tracks running Monday through Wednesday earlier on in the year. Fauner Park made a lot of money doing that. You mentioned Chris Black, the GM there. So a lot of things going on, a lot of things to keep an eye on Twitter. Just keep an open mind. Use brain before engaging Twitter fingers. I think that's the main takeaway here.
All you got to do is look both ways. The old wise man said, look both ways before crossing the street. And it's true. I mean, you know that when you're looking at a post, that if that particular individual is trying to draw you in, a lot of it is bait and they're chumming the waters just to get a reaction. So just have to kind of know where to swim and navigate yourself accordingly. Because if not, you're just – go back to the idea that you allow it to consume you. And, you know, for the number of years that I've been on TVG, which it'll be 15 this year, unfortunately, with the COVID-19 pandemic, it's been since March that I've worked on the air because essentially everything is stay at home here. And I don't foresee that changing until the turn of the year. Obviously, Andrew, we work together. You know that as a host, as an analyst, you have a job to do. So essentially, when you're giving out horses for every race and you're giving out every pick four that comes available, you know what that strike rate is. And, obviously for me in an idealistic of scenarios, I would have much preferred to say, hey, I've got a key horse for you today, guys. He's 6-1 today. I think he's a wise, a wise key horse for your exotics, pick fours, pick sixes or whatnot, as opposed to having a selection for every race. Because in the end of the day, if you've been on every race, I'm fairly certain that you're going to end up losing in the end. It's impossible to do that.
Yeah, no kidding. So, Sarge, you mentioned hasn't necessarily been a time of year where people can find you on TVG. But as we wrap things up in this conversation, where can people find you for some of the things that you've been doing? Plug whatever you'd like to plug as far as the things that you're working on, the things you're excited about. Floor is yours.
Well, Andrew, I'm actually, the horses are being my life, and my plan is in September to be at the Keeneland September Yearling Sale, obviously in conjunction and advising for myracehorse.com. So heavily invested there as far as my time. In regard to the claiming game, Battleborn Racing Stable is who I race under, as many of you know. I've got some partners on certain horses. I have no partners on others. We race across the nation. I've got horses in training in Maryland, Scott Lake. Obviously, I mentioned Jim Chapman in Kentucky. Billy Morey has done some work there. Here in California, Jonathan Long, Richard Baltus. So Battleborn Racing Stable, perhaps a segue if you wanted to get into the game or talk shop and claiming, but having the ability to go to these sales, I take great pride in having the opportunity to select horses and scout on client partner behalf. But in regard to the social media world, I'm easy to find on Twitter at Hindsight, H-I-N-E-S-I-T-E, on Facebook, just under my name, Nick J. Hines. But Andrew, I've kind of toyed with the idea, and I know I talked to you about this better over a year ago about potentially having a show and maybe just giving out pick four selections over the weekend. So I may do that, and perhaps there's a way that we and indeed could work together or touch in a possible way. So that's what I'm up to for the here's and nows. It's all about the horses and day-to-day activity, buying, selling, sales, and managing and hopefully winning.
Nick, it's always a pleasure to talk shop with you. We really appreciate you coming on the show. Unfortunately, JD a little under the weather, but we know he's going to get well soon. We'll obviously have you back. You're not just one of the best guys in racing, you're one of the best guys that I know. So thank you very much for coming by. We really appreciate it. Give him an oorah, and then I'll give him the catchphrase.
Oorah.
Stay off the beaches, everybody. Have a good weekend.